Tech. Before I introduce today's speaker, as I usually do, I'll tell you the next speaker. So we'll be meeting again on February 14th. It's the second Tuesday in February. And the speaker will be Professor Hua Wang from Electrical and Computer Engineering. So it's a real pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Martha Grover from Chemical and Biomolecular Engineering here at Georgia Tech. Martha got her bachelor's degree in mechanical engineering at the University of Illinois and then went west to Caltech, where she got her master's and PhD also in mechanical engineering, before coming to Georgia Tech in 2003, where she is currently in the School of Chemical and Biomolecular Engineering, where she's currently a professor and James Harris Faculty Fellow. She, among her awards, was given an NSF Career Award in 2004. And so it's a real pleasure to have Martha with us.
Thank you. I'm happy to be here today. Hello to you all in the back. Can you hear me okay?
No.
Okay, if not, feel free to move up. Or let me know to speak up, but I'll try to. So I'm going to talk to you today about some research in my group at the intersection of feedback control and nanomaterials. So those two areas don't always go together, but what I'd like to do is tell you about some of our findings and why I think this can be an important area going forward. So broadly within my group, we aim to design and control to engineer macromolecular assembly. And in particular, we focus on problems where the material is not, in the end, at its equilibrium state, so that the dynamics or the kinetics of the material structure evolution during processing need to be considered in designing a process to give you a desired product. And so we look at a broad range of different applications in this area, including covalent bonding, so more classic chemistry, or non-covalent interactions, maybe more physics. But in either case, we look at the general problem of how to assemble many often indistinguishable particles. And we also focus often on the formation of defects and then how to avoid them. Usually we want to have perfectly ordered structures and avoid, say, defects in a crystalline lattice like grain boundaries or voids. We're also interested in spatial organization, clustering dynamics, and overall, the idea is to look at look for very general problems and very general approaches, but then to apply and validate them in very specific applications, including in experiments. And so the images here at the bottom are all different projects that either I'm actively working on now or have worked on in the past. On the left, we have silver nanoparticle deposition on paper fibers. The next one is a molecular dynamic simulation of polymer interactions. The next one over is pharmaceutical crystallization. And finally, at the end, that's a lattice Monte Carlo simulation in my research in the Center for Chemical Evolution on origins of life chemistry. But just to set the stage for these problems, I wanted to kind of go through the various considerations that one needs to identify and address when coming up with a product, okay, made from a material. So first you need to decide what kind of chemistry am I going to look at. Then how am I going to process those molecules in order to get a particular material structure? So it could be a crystal, or it could be a hyperbranched polymer and how it's connected to each other, but a particular material structure. And then ultimately, that structure, as well as the chemistry, determine the resulting properties of the material, so maybe conductivity or elasticity. And then those properties are needed in order to understand the functioning of the product that you're going to make. So the area that I'm generally very interested in is the relationship between process and structure. Okay? So in my group, we do look at structure-property relationships, but that's not the key focus. There's a lot of research in structure-property relationships, but I would argue that the process-structure relationship is understudied and very important. You know? So if we want to look at scaling up a nanomaterial, into a high throughput process so that we can sell that product, we need to really understand the product process structure relationship so that we can come up with a viable process. It's not enough to make one structure and measure its properties and note that they're novel and interesting, but we need to be able to process these materials in a high throughput setting in order to really realize the vision of nanotechnology. So in some materials, we have a perfect crystal, and then we don't really need to worry about the process structure relationship. If we have that perfect crystal, we're all set. It's at its thermodynamic equilibrium. Same is true if we have a disordered liquid. But there are many cases in materials processing where we have non-equilibrium structures, like glasses or polycrystalline materials. They may be desirable or they may be undesirable to have those non-equilibrium structures. But when we have those, then we need to think about the kinetics of the assembly, which is the same thing as the dynamics of the process. And I want to just define a couple of terms that I'm going to use going forward. So the first is self-assembly. So probably most of you are familiar with that term. But that refers to the interactions between individual components of a system that result in the spontaneous organization of those components. Okay, so it says there can occur at any scale. So it could be molecules, could be particles, or it could be planets. But here we're going to think more about atoms and molecules up to micron-sized particles. But the next phrase is one that I just want to precisely define: externally directing self-assembly. So this refers to manipulation of the external environment. That's the control part. So we're going to manipulate the external environment to adjust the component interactions during self-assembly. Now, there's another term that's sometimes used: directing or directed self-assembly. But I want to distinguish from just the directed part. Because that can refer to kind of a redesign or modification of maybe the component particles to change the assembly, but not necessarily externally changing some field, a knob on our process. So I'm going to talk about the problem of externally directing self-assembly, also known as control of crystallization. So I've already kind of referred to some of the points on this slide, but the motivation for this work is that we want to be able to manufacture structured materials with very low defect density in large quantities. One application is to make metamaterials for optoelectronic applications, where we want to assemble a large number of colloidal particles here. Just means solid particles suspended in a liquid. But here the particles are about 1 micron, which means that they can interact with light in interesting and novel ways, even to make invisibility cloaks, as well as to steer light in optoelectronics applications. So self-assembly has a greater potential for scale-up relative to top-down patterning, where it's very serial. But the challenge is in defect formation. So we could wait a very, very long time to get a perfect crystal, and that would be the thermodynamic ground state of the system. So that's helpful, that's where the system is going. But there's kind of a catch-22 in which you need to wait an infinite amount of time to reach the fully ordered state. And then if you process the system faster, then you'll probably have defects that would be undesirable for the performance of these metamaterials. So the idea to try to get around this sort of catch-22 or inherent trade-off is to use feedback control. Okay? So by manipulating external potentials, we can identify when a defect is just starting to form and then to take a corrective action only when needed in order to heal out that defect and then get back on the path to assembling a perfect crystal. Okay, so that was a lot of words, but let's watch a movie. So this is an experiment with my collaborator, Michael Bevan at Johns Hopkins, who studies colloidal interactions in assembly. And this is an experiment of his in his lab under a microscope. These particles are about 1 micron in size. And we're using voltage as our externally manipulated variable. And I'll talk more about the details later. But One really great thing for feedback is that we can measure all the particle positions. We have really full state feedback here. We can measure everything in real time. This is essential if you want to do feedback control. You have to measure things during the process, right? So, you know, maybe we can do this now with in situ TEM. You can do it at much smaller length scales, but the colloidal particles are very convenient in order to study crystallization phenomenon as well as to look at manufacturing of metamaterials. But voltage is our externally applied input. The driving force for assembly here is dielectrophoresis. And when this lambda value is high, that means we're pushing really hard with the voltage. The particles are being pushed to the middle. And when it's low, then they're allowed to relax. But one thing you can see here, this is going through 10 different cycles of this experiment. There's a grain boundary there. Okay, so that's bad in this case. We want to have perfectly assembled crystals. And so if we just keep pushing on the system, it's going to take a really long time for that grain boundary to anneal out. So now we're going to, on cycle 6, we push hard, we see a small grain boundary there, we relax it because we saw it forming, and now we push hard again, and now we can get a perfect crystal. So because we have feedback, we can apply targeted correction in order to get rapid assembly. So that's really the whole talk. So you could leave now that you've eaten your pizza, but anyway, don't leave. We'll have more movies. Okay, so if you've taken a controls class or are a little bit familiar with the area of controls, there's a lot of block diagrams. So I thought I'd make a block diagram for you. It's a block diagram. There are four key components in a feedback control system. The first one is the process, okay? Or sometimes, so it might not be a process, it could be a robot or something in control, but I'm in chemical engineering, we look at processes. But you know, this is our system that we want to control. Here, let's think about that colloidal assembly example, okay? So another important thing is if you want to do feedback, you have to measure something during the process. You need to get that regular information about the state of the system. Otherwise, you can do recipe design, you can do all sorts of things in terms of engineering, but you can't do feedback. You can't do feedback control. So in this case, our sensor is optical video microscopy plus image processing, and we do that in real time. Within about a second, we can get all the centers of mass of all the particles, 300 particles. So, and that's plenty fast for this process. The next piece is our controller. If we're going to do control, this is some kind of rule where we take in what it is that we're trying to achieve. So maybe we want to have perfect crystallinity according to some order parameter. Metric, and then we compute usually also that same order parameter for what we currently have, and sometimes we just compare them, we subtract them, and that's called the error. It's an official control variable, but just the difference between what you want and what you have, and then you use the controller to decide how we're going to act on the system, right? So the fourth piece here is called the actuator, kind of a fancy term, but it's acting. Right? That's the first part of actuator. So it's just how we act on the system. And in this particular case, it's the voltage. We're applying an external potential to the field, not at every location. It's just one scalar quantity is the overall amplitude of this AC voltage that we're applying to drive dielectrophoretic assembly, to push the particles to the middle. Okay. So every time we take a new measurement, we update our actuator, and then we measure again, and we keep going around this closed loop. So this closed loop control, because we have closed the loop here. Okay, so I just wanted to focus just a little bit more on this. You know, our task here is to design this control law, this mathematical equation or computer code that's going to say, well, here's what I have, and here's what I want, and how do I act on the system right now? And so there are some different ways that we can think about developing this controller. So, and I've divided those into model-based and model-free. So if you have a model-based controller, then if you have a model of the system, you can calculate, here is the best way to respond under every possible state of the system to achieve my objective. Okay, so this is very nice sort of formally, but it requires having a good model of the system, which, say, nanomaterials, we don't always have, okay? But this would be ideal, and then you can best, meaning optimal, so I had optimal in the title of my talk, same as best, okay, according to our objective. But an alternative is model-free control, which is simpler, and then we don't have to really worry if we have an accurate model or not. So we can just calculate, okay, I want to have a perfectly ordered structure, but I have some defects, so my crystallinity is 0.9 and my desired is 1.0, and so my error is 0.1, and so turn up the voltage or turn down the voltage. In this case, it's not so clear that a proportional control law like that or an integral control law would really help you, that because it's a nonlinear system, you might need to, even though you want to assemble, you should push less hard so you can relax and then you can allow yourself to move forward again because you kind of got stuck. Okay. So these simple model-free controllers don't always do the job, but they're known as sometimes PID controllers, proportional integral derivative, so maybe you've seen or used or heard of PID controllers. So that's an example of a model-free controller. But today I'm going to talk to you about our work with model-based controllers. And of course, you know, as with any kind of decision-making problem, you have to specify what you want, right? So then the controller will only be optimal for that particular objective. So you have to be careful, and then sometimes you realize, oh, well, that seemed like what I wanted, but really I wanted this, and then you go back and you redesign your controller because your objective changed. You know. So you have to specify everything mathematically in terms of what you want. And then the controller for the colloidal crystallization, and also for the salt crystallization that I'll talk about later, is all implemented on a personal computer using MATLAB to do the computation. So anyway, the computation is not really that difficult online. I'll talk more about that. Okay, so this all sounds, you know, maybe sounds fine. Okay, let's go ahead and measure and take corrective action. So what's hard about that? Well, there are a lot of things that are hard about this problem that maybe don't appear at more macroscopic scales. We have a very high dimension of our dynamics here because we have all these different particles. I mean, here we only have 300, but, you know, you could have a mole or something, right? You know, so you don't, that's a very high dimensional system. The dynamics are stochastic, so when we push on the colloidal system, when we push hard on it, sometimes it forms a grain boundary, but sometimes it doesn't. Okay, so we have a significant stochasticity to our dynamics that needs to be accounted for in our controller design, as well as the dynamics being nonlinear. So there's so much we can do with linear algebra in terms of computation, and very little that we can do with nonlinear systems, actually. And usually, then, if we have a nonlinear system, sometimes we linearize. Okay, so anyway, it's much harder to control a nonlinear system than it is a linear system. So we also have limited actuation here. You know, I said I want something scalable. I don't want to go in a serial fashion and place each atom in its position. So therefore, you know, here I only have one voltage that I can change, but I have 300 particles. So I can't just move them all independently of each other. Okay, so that's limited ability to act on the system. And then limited sensors for real-time measurement. Now, this is not really true for this colloidal assembly problem. We really have great sensor because we're looking at the system under the optical microscope. But often we might have a diffraction pattern, or we might be doing spectroscopy, and we don't actually have the position, say, of every atom. So these are some sort of general challenges. And the approach that we have taken over the years in my group is one that we started off looking actually in gallium arsenide homoepitaxy simulations. And it was an idea that we developed here in simulation, published here in 2008. And now we've taken forward in these two different applications, colloidal crystallization and salt crystallization, that I'll talk about today. But the idea is basically that we need to think about these three steps, okay? And we need to address these three steps. So first we need to, even though we have all these different particle locations, 300 particles with their XY coordinates, the colloidal assembly is just a 2D assembly, it's on a surface, right? But anyway, we have all these different positions. We don't really care about the position of every atom. We want to control the ordering of the system, right? So we need some order parameters that tell us about properties that we care about, and hopefully also allow us to predict the future evolution of those properties to have a dynamic model. So we need to select some variables to characterize the aggregate state of the system. And we need to measure those in real time. Now, if you're a controls person, then you might say, well, I don't really have to measure them. I could have a model and an observer, and I could estimate them. And that's all true. But because our approach is very based on data and feedback, I think that what I would like to argue is that you really want to, as much as possible, build your measure those important aggregate states, or everything is going to be much more difficult. Okay, so you don't have to do that, but if you can, that would really be best. I've also spent a lot of over the years looking, building observers for systems, and that can be very challenging, and sometimes we never quite get to the controls piece. So I like these two applications of salt crystallization and colloidal crystallization in that we did not have to build observers, and then we could just move straight to control. So basically, so that we have state feedback. Okay, so step one is to select these aggregate variables that that you think are enough to characterize the overall organization of that, of the configuration of the system. Second step is then to build a model of the system dynamics in terms of those aggregate state metrics from step one. Okay? So we're going to use data. Either it could be from a detailed simulation or it could be from experiment. But we're going to build this nonlinear stochastic model empirically from data. Once we do that, then we can use dynamic programming to calculate the optimal state feedback law. So we use an approach called Markov decision process to do that. But once you have a predictive model and you're measuring the states, you can really go forward and then you can do optimal feedback control. And this is kind of a cartoon of how you might go about this. In the colloidal assembly case, now we have either experimental data. We also have simulation data from a particle level simulator, high dimensional simulator. So we generate samples of the system. These axes here are our aggregate variables. So for the colloidal crystallization, we have a local ordering of the system here and a global ordering. And so we want both of those to be high in the end. You know. But we run simulations or we take data and we see, well, where did the system go? Where did we see the system in terms of these aggregate variables at different input levels? So maybe red is high voltage and blue is low voltage. So often it happens that under different conditions, the system will sample different regions of that state space. Okay. But then we move forward to build our empirical model by clustering these samples. So we say, well, two points that have similar, you know, aggregate metrics, order parameters are similar. They're going to evolve similarly in the future, and we're going to group them into these different boxes. So we have now a finite number of discrete states that our system can take. Now, if we want to build a dynamic model in terms of these states, then we need to know where does the system go under the red input, high voltage, starting in this box, and also under the blue input. Okay? So we can make a decision about which input to use at that time. So we're going to need to probably do some more sampling of the system to go in so that we have both red and blue dots in each box, so that we can make a decision about which input to use. We need that information before we can go forward. But once we have that information, now we can build our empirical dynamic model. We have, in the colloidal crystallization case, built them models using Markov state model, which really just means under this state, track where the system goes after some fixed period of time under each input. And then we build a probability map for the system. So it's a stochastic model. The system could go here or here with different probabilities based on how many times we observe that transition. And finally, once we have the Markov state model, then we can calculate our optimal controller. And what the controller ends up being is a lookup table, which is very convenient for online implementation. So we say, well, if I'm in this box right now, I measure the state of the system, all the positions, and then I calculate the order parameters. I say, okay, I'm in this box, it's blue, so I'm going to do the low voltage for the next time step. Then I take another measurement, and then I see where I am. Oh, now I moved over here. Now I'm in a red box. Now I need to raise the voltage high. But the online computation then ends up being very, very simple, just a lookup table, which is very useful in terms of getting intuition about the system and also dealing with our collaborators. Okay, so that's not the only way that you could implement this approach. So we could, instead of using physically based order parameters to characterize our system, we could use machine learning methods based on ideas like principal component analysis in order to figure out what is that reduced state of the system. We could use other modeling based approaches. We could use other controller designs like PID or model predictive control. But we think this is a general approach that has a lot of nice features for online implementation and has the ability to be generalized. Okay. So I'm going to talk to you about two different case studies today. I've already alluded to them, the colloidal crystallization I've shown you more about here. And these particles are about 1 micron. And then the salt crystallization case. So this is the macroscopic system that we have. We have these bulk sensors, focused beam reflectance measurement for particle size, infrared absorption for solution composition, and then Here's the crystallization vessel in here, temperature controlled. We're going to do cooling crystallization. And here are the crystals. So these crystals are something like maybe 10 to 100 microns. So they're bigger than these particles, but this scale is sort of similar to this scale here. But the molecules that make up these crystals then are small molecules, so you know, nanometer. So they're actually much smaller in terms of the crystallization phenomenon. And as opposed to having all the particle positions available to us in real time, here in the salt crystallization, we just have these more bulk properties. But that ultimately form the aggregate states that we measure. We build our empirical model in terms of those measured properties, like total number of crystals and total mass of crystal, that we can measure online and build a model in terms of those variables. So even though here, you know, it seems great that we have all this information about all the particle positions, in fact, we don't end up really using it. And so I think this is good, because you, in a manufacturing setting, you wouldn't really want to be looking at every particle under a microscope. Okay? You'd want to use bulk aggregate measurements. So just to contrast these two cases, we select our aggregate variables first. And so in the colloidal crystallization, we use a local order parameter, C6, in which you just look at each particle and say, does it have six neighbors nearby within some cutoff radius? And then you calculate the average over all particles. So that's the local ordering. But you can have good local ordering and bad global ordering if you have, say, a grain boundary down the middle and a bicrystal. So local order isn't really enough. And so that's something that we found through some iterative learning, trial and error, is that we really needed both the local and the global crystallinity metric. Are all the atoms aligned onto a single lattice? In order to describe the dynamics of the system. Now, for salt crystallization, as I said, we have this really macroscopic system. We nucleate crystals, and then they grow. And in this case, we measure the total mass of crystals through infrared solution measurement. We know how much material we start with. We know how much is in solution. Therefore, we know the difference is what's in crystal. So we know crystal mass. And then we can estimate crystal number from our focus beam reflectance measurement, which is a laser backscattering measurement. So we just say, that's what we can measure robustly. Let's try to build a dynamic model based on our measured variables. And so then we build models to learn the dynamics. So in both cases, colloidal crystallization and salt crystallization, we discretize the state space into little boxes. We discretize the time into some, you know, delta t at which we will update the input. And we also discretize our action space. So instead of saying the voltage could be anywhere between 0 and 1 volt, we're going to just pick some representative levels that we'll consider. We'll switch between those levels. And that allows us to efficiently calculate the optimal control policy for that discretized system. And in the case of the colloidal crystallization, we chose to build a probabilistic model for this Markov state model because there was significant stochasticity under the same conditions. Sometimes we get a grain boundary right down the middle, very bad. Sometimes we don't. So we wanted to have a stochastic model. We didn't see that same level of stochasticity for the crystallization. We also were building our model directly from data in that case. In the colloidal crystallization, we built it from a detailed simulator that was a good surrogate for the model. And so therefore, it was easier to generate more data. So in any case, we built a deterministic model, but still a Markov state model for the salt crystallization. So we said, if I start in this point here, after some period of time under this input, I'm going to go here. So we didn't have probabilities of going different places. And then we calculated the control policies. And again, as I said, it was going to be a lookup table. So for the colloidal crystallization system, we said we want to get to high global and local order. And we're going to start down here in the fluid state with no order. And so depending on where we are, then we look up the action to take. And so what this told us is, if the local order is not real high, then just push really hard on the system. Blue is the high voltage. But if you get into a situation where you have high local order and low global order, that's a grain boundary. Okay, so you're going to need to heal that out before you can move over to this corner where we have high local order. And so here this is really low, so low voltage, so maybe we're almost completely remelting. And then as we get closer and closer over here where maybe the grain boundary's at the edge, we don't want to completely melt everything. That would be inefficient. So we use more of an intermediate voltage. And then we have a similar lookup table for the salt crystallization, but now it's mass and number of crystals. And our input here to our actuator is the supersaturation of the system. So do we have more solute molecules than are soluble in the system that will drive crystallization versus less, where we'll actually dissolve crystals? So it's a similar kind of phenomenon where if we start to move away from our target properties, where we move away from our target, here we want to have high mass and low number, so large crystals. Usually you want large crystals so you have low surface area, you can wash them nicely for separation applications. The motivation here and funding actually comes for nuclear waste separation. And so we want to have low surface area so we can really wash any contaminants off. We're trying to nucleate out non-radioactive salts from a large amount of nuclear waste at the Hanford site in Washington State. So that's what we want, but if we somehow our crystals are getting too small, maybe we should dissolve some of them, and then we should try to get back to our target. Okay, so here are some more details about the colloidal assembly system. This is this collaboration with Michael Bevan's group at Johns Hopkins. And we have this quadrupole electrode, so this is kind of the macroscopic system, and we just apply a single AC voltage across it, and it creates kind of a parabolic well in terms of the potential energy for each particle that pushes the particles to the center. But we have 300 silica particles, 300 micron in diameter, they're in water, it's a quasi 2D assembly, they're on a surface. So we can watch them under the microscope. We don't have to look at overlap of particles. Although you could do confocal microscopy, and they do in the Bevan group, to look at 3D assembly. We have particle interactions that are reversible. So in some colloidal assembly applications, once the particles stick, they don't come apart again. You know, but we'd like to be able to reverse the system so we can undo something, so we can back up if we went too far. So that's usually a good feature in control, to be able to move in both directions. And then we have this dielectrophoresis where our particle field interactions drive the assembly process. At certain frequencies, it pulls everything to the middle. We can actually push away also, although we didn't do that in this particular application. We just would let the system relax. And then we have this real-time monitoring with optical video microscopy. So there has been some work in the past in control of crystallization, but not very much, really not very much. So I think in colloidal crystallization, these four papers kind of summarize some of the key approaches that have been taken. The control can be open loop or closed loop. So when I talk about control, really I'm talking about closed loop control, where we measure something during the process, we make an adjustment, and we keep going around that loop. But you can think about control more broadly as designing the recipe. So there has been some work at MIT in looking at a colloidal assembly and simulation to drive the system between kind of local thermodynamic minima waypoints from a design perspective and modeling a design. There's been some work in experiments on periodic switching of the system between high and low to get fewer defects in your system by Eric First's group at Delaware. In the closed-loop control area, there has not been very much, but there was a paper from Michigan by Klotzka and Jack in 2013 looking in simulation at some heuristic switching rules for colloidal assembly. If you see a certain order parameter combination, then you should switch maybe to a lower or higher voltage. And then finally, I want to mention the work on proportional control, model-free control by my collaborator Michael Bevan, which they published in 2012. Which was an experiment. So that was probably the only experimental closed-loop control that had been shown in colloidal assembly. I think I want to go on to the next. Let me go here. So I want to talk about that study. So in a proportional controller, you measure what you have. They were looking at local ordering, C6. And then they were comparing what they have to what they want. So the solid line here is the set point, the desired value. And so there's some error. And based on that error in C6, they would either turn up or turn down the voltage. That's this green here. And so they were doing proportional control to try to drive the system up to its maximum value of C6. And what they found was that kind of worked for low levels of order. But once they wanted to get to the really high order, they had this offset in their proportional controller. And that's something that's known to happen in proportional control, because as you crank up the proportionality constant, then you require too high of an action, and so you have the steady state error. And so this is kind of where they had gotten when I got involved in the project, is that they had implemented feedback control. They had all the hardware and software integrated, but they didn't really have the control law that they needed. It wasn't model-based. So in a model-based controller, you have a model of the system, and then you specify what it is that you want, and then you calculate what would be the best action at all times for all states. And so here's a little bit of the math. J is the objective function, or the cost function. And so what that is it says, well, at each step in the process, there's some cost associated with being in a particular state and taking a particular action. Plus, there's a terminal cost at the end of the process. So I'm going to add up the total cost over the process. And because it's a stochastic process, I'm going to put an expectation on there, which is just an average over a noisy system. So once you specify what's the cost of being at a particular state, which is, say, it's costly to not be in a fully crystalline state, then you can just go ahead and you can calculate using Bellman's principle. You can work backwards from the end of the process and say, what would have been the best way to get there to get to that ending point from all possible starting points. And so there are well-defined numerical methods, algorithms to do this that have been around for maybe 100 years, but they haven't been practical until much more recently because computers were not available to actually solve this problem. Okay, so this is a model-based controller, so we need a model, right, in order to implement this. And so in the colloidal assembly problem, I already told you we have two models. We have the Brownian dynamic simulation, which is a particle-level detailed simulator that's kind of a surrogate for the experiment. The Bevan group had built this previously. Here's a paper in 2011 where they documented this simulation. It includes drag forces, random Brownian motion, external forces on the system, but you're basically just solving Newton's equation of motion on each particle, but it's a coupled system. So we have that simulation available to us to generate data to build our empirical model, but then we also need to build this Markov state model in which we discretize the state space, and then we build these matrices, probability matrices, for transitioning from each discrete state to every other discrete state over a transition time that we choose. And so we chose a time of 100 seconds, which was long enough for the system to sort of significantly change. And then we also discretized our actuator space. So we picked different voltage levels, 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, and 0.95 of the maximum voltage that we could use. We don't want the system to buckle. We want it to stay two-dimensional. So that determined our upper level of the voltage. And we also didn't want the particles to float out of our optical window, and so that's why we have this 0.1 here and why we're not actually having repulsive forces and blowing the system apart if there's a defect, because we want to keep everything in the window. So those are just practical constraints. But we built this Markov state model, and we used the Brownian dynamic simulations to build those transition matrices. And this is the result of that calculation of dynamic programming optimal control through the Markov decision process formulation, where we got this lookup table. So I already kind of described this lookup table to you, but this is the control policy for global order. We measure the current global order and local order, and then we say, okay, well, what color am I in currently? And that tells me what action to take for the next 100 seconds. And here's our overall cost function. And here we have the stage-wise cost is simply the value of the global order parameter. We want to have perfect global order of 1. Anything less than that is bad, and we're going to penalize ourselves for that. So this is the objective function that we're using. So here's how it worked out. We have this C6 here and Psi6 here, and using our model, we can calculate the free energy landscape for each of these four different voltage levels that provides our input. And so we can visualize the system in terms of evolution, in terms of free energy landscapes. For a while, maybe we're at high voltage, and then we jump down to low voltage, and then we evolve for a while there, and then we pop back up. We can also map these different measured configurations, 1 through 6, onto that space. And what the optimal policy tells us is that if we're in state 5 or 4 or 6, any of those, even though, you know, there's clearly a grain boundary here and this one's pretty disordered, we should still push really hard. We should use the high input. It's only if we have, you know, this really persistent grain boundary here, state 3, that we fully apply the very lowest voltage. If we have a smaller grain boundary here, then we should just apply kind of an intermediate voltage to help heal that out. And then this is our desired state here, the perfect crystal. So we applied this policy first in Brownian dynamic simulation. You know, if your policy or your design doesn't work, in the simulation, it's never going to work in the experiment, right? So it's always best to try it out in everything in simulation first. We already had this detailed simulator. So we applied the policy, and what we found is that basically we could achieve assembly 93% of the time in 1,000 seconds compared to 62% if we just applied the high voltage and hope for the best. So the other 38% of the time we would get grain boundaries that would form when we push really hard. And so here we can follow the global ordering over time, and the colors here correspond to realizations that went through a big grain boundary or a little grain boundary or no grain boundary for the blue ones. So those are, but the black line here is the average, and we can see over the 1,000 seconds we can assemble pretty much all of our systems. Then we did it in experiments, and actually the nice surprise here was it actually worked better. You know, really it would have been best if it worked the same, because that would mean that our model was really accurate. But in any case, actually 100 out of 100 cases it assembled, but it behaved, you know, similarly. But actually, we were actually able to assemble all 100 times in that 1,000 seconds. And this just gives you a little more picture of what might be going on for 10 different realizations of the system. So here in blue is the local ordering and the global ordering. And then here's the voltage action that's commanded by our policy. So what happened in cycle two, first we melted everything to get going. We applied the high voltage, and we got good local order, but not global order. So then in the next time interval, we relax the system, but at an intermediate level, not the lowest level. Then we tried again. We got a little farther, so the grain boundary is kind of scooting over, presumably, but not all the way. So now we take a different, less aggressive relaxation, and then finally, boom, okay, we were able to assemble. But most of the time, we actually didn't need that corrective action, and this is kind of the point. You shouldn't do this all the time. You should only do it when it's needed, and that's what feedback allows you. And it also tells you how much to relax, for how long or at what level. Okay, so here's a movie showing assembly where here we can follow the evolution of the system on the free energy landscapes. So each of these four levels corresponds to a particular input. Here we can follow the system on terms of the policy in the order parameter space. And finally, here's the actual experimental system. So we're at the high level here. We've got some defects. So we're going to take a new sample and say, oh, better jump down to that intermediate level. We're going to let the system evolve for 100 seconds. Then we're going to say, OK, that was helpful. We pop back up. But now we still have that kind of smaller defect on the edge, you know? So we're going to go back down to the third level, evolve for another 100 seconds, and then try again. And there we got there. So that's how it works. So I know I don't have too much longer, but I want to talk about the second case study. I'm going to talk about this more briefly, but to point out some of the parallels. In this case, we formulated the optimal control problem in terms of a finite time horizon. In the colloidal control, we actually did an infinite horizon control policy calculation where we just said, you know, we want the system to have high crystallinity now and in the future, and that's our objective. So, you know, just a slightly different algorithm. Both are very well-defined algorithms. But here we said we want to assemble the system in a fixed period of time. And as a result, we got a control policy, a lookup table, that was actually different at different points in time. So we still have our two aggregate variables here, crystal mass and crystal number. But at 15 minutes early in the process, we have one lookup table. At 115 minutes later, at the end of the process, we have a different table. But in any case, you know, we take a measurement. We get the table for that corresponding period of time. We say, well, I'm right here. I'm blue. I need a negative supersaturation to basically dissolve my crystals to push me backward. Okay? If we're in the orange space, then we want a positive supersaturation to drive forward nucleation and growth. And then here we can watch the evolution of the system under the uncontrolled case with just linear cooling, in which we come up here, so we're over in this region that has a large number of crystals and a large mass. Okay? But with our control policy, using this policy here, we were able to get to our target value of having high mass but low number, so large crystals. And let's watch that evolution here. So again, here's our physical system. We measure basically particle number here and infrared here to get particle mass. We have temperature. And then we actually have an internal PI loop in a cascade control, because our input here is supersaturation of the solution, but we're really manipulating temperature. And temperature then affects solubility, that affects supersaturation. So we have these kind of two loops here, but we're really focusing here on just that main loop where we view supersaturation as a manipulated variable, even though it's not directly manipulated. Okay, so we're going to start here with no crystals, and we're going to try to get to this target here. So the map is going to be changing colors now because we have a time-varying policy, because we formulated this as a time-varying optimal control policy. And this is an example of the crystals that we are growing in this process. Diraspskite, but it's sodium, nitrate, sulfate, and this is a representative mineral in the nuclear waste separation project. So we start down here, and we have to wait. Nucleation is a stochastic phenomenon, but now it goes. Now it went. Whoop. So now we go quickly, and we might have overshot, right? So we're going to try to kind of move up to the target, but we're still both growing and nucleating more crystals. So we moved over here, okay? So now it's going to help. Now we're going to dissolve some of them. It's going to push us back to the target. So this is experimental, experimental result, an example of this control policy, where our final time was 60 minutes, so 1 hour. So again, this is not so fast that we don't have time to respond and do feedback control. And so we have a relatively long sampling time and update time for our control policy that still allows us to manipulate the system. So we really aren't dealing with kind of sampling and bandwidth issues in either case. OK, so with that, I'd like to wrap up. I think that we can do optimal feedback control in molecular and nanoscale self-assembly. I think it's feasible as long as we have the sensors to do it. Model-based optimal control promises better performance than something like a PID controller in many cases, particularly in these crystallization cases where we have defects that sometimes form that we want to get rid of. We could still, there's room for improvement in the results of our controllers in simulation and experiment, which probably means we need better models. But our models were still pretty effective in getting a feedback control policy. And just the act of applying feedback confers some robustness to unmodeled effects as well. Because if you know what you have and you know which direction to kind of act in, then you can still get to your target. Also, the technology for real-time imaging and sensing is continuing. That was a surprise. Continuing to advance, so especially exciting are advances in in situ TEM, where we can watch individual atoms move in real time, and we could do something similar to the colloidal crystallization example, as well as 3D imaging with confocal microscopy. And in a manufacturing setting, we might not really want optical video microscopy and image processing for feedback, but because we would have way too many particles, that wouldn't really be practical. But the insights we gained in terms of identifying order parameters and using that for control, and then applying that in the salt crystallization example where we didn't have full position our coordinate feedback, tells us that really, as long as we know what are important aggregate properties and we can measure them in real time, then we can apply this approach of building empirical models in terms of measured variables and computing our optimal policy in that space. And that could be applied to then, you know, whatever simpler sensors we have available in the manufacturing setting. So I'd like to also acknowledge funding from the National Science Foundation for the colloidal assembly project and from the Consortium for Risk Evaluation with Stakeholder Participation funded by DOE for the nuclear waste separation crystallization case, as well as a fellowship for Dan from the Nuclear Energy Program. I want to acknowledge both of these students, Dr. Dan Griffin and Dr. Xuyin Tong. Both of them graduated in the last 6 months. So Dan worked on the salt crystallization, and Xuyin worked on the colloidal crystallization. Those were their thesis projects. And also my collaborators, Michael Bavin in the colloidal crystallization area, and Ron Rousseau and Yoshi Kawajiri, who's here, in the crystallization case. Also, I'll just put up a couple of recent papers here. We published a paper in ACS Nano this summer on the colloidal crystallization and on the salt crystallization also this year in ICR. And there's also a conference paper that's fully available, a tutorial conference paper describing the two applications and comparing them that we also published at the American Control Conference this year. So thank you for your attention, and I'd be happy to take any questions.
Sensors which you use for measurement, the real-time measurement of the colloidal assembly.
in the colloidal assembly. So in the colloidal assembly, the particles are each about 1 micrometer in size, 1 micron. And so we have an optical microscope. So we watch them under the microscope. We have a camera, digital camera, and we do image processing in real time to find the center of mass of each particle.
So the measurement variable is basically the center of mass of each particle?
And yes. Well, that is available to us for feedback. But what we then determined is that two key order parameters for the system were the local crystallinity and the global crystallinity, which are calculated from the center of mass of every particle. So once we have the center of mass of every particle, then we calculate these smaller number of features, and we use that for feedback. We also use that to build our dynamic model. That's our dynamic state in our dynamic model, and it is measured in real time.
So the whole optimality principle in all this work is Richard Feynman's principle of optimality, the dynamic programming? Or you also
yes.
Use some other objective function and some other...
Our objective function for the optimal control calculation from Bellman's principle is specified in terms of these two aggregate variables. In fact, we only use the global order in specifying our cost function, our stage-wise cost, and our terminal cost.
What is the physical nonlinearity about which you are talking, and where is the mathematical model which is derived from first principles of physics?
It is, so we do have a Brownian dynamic simulation that we use as a surrogate model. But this approach does not require that. And in the sole crystallization example, we did not use it. We built an empirical dynamic model, stochastic and nonlinear, using probability transition matrices.
So what's the source of nonlinearity?
In crystallization, nucleation is highly nonlinear. In terms of the physical underlying physics, it's often described in terms of classical nucleation theory, which has a log term, it has supersaturation in the denominator, so it is highly nonlinear. Growth is also expressed in terms of usually a power law, more empirical model, but that is also nonlinear in supersaturation. So there are physical models for these processes, but what I'm arguing here is if you are measuring the data in real time online, build a Markov state model instead. You'll get to your goal faster. But you can use a model-based approach. And in the colloidal crystallization example, we did use a simulation, the Brownian dynamic simulation, which has in it voltage forces, Coulombic interactions, a lot of different physical effects as our experiment, because it did match, it was validated and matched the experiments very well. But that was in terms of physical principles.
Mm-hmm. And that's sort of a presumption that you've made, or because of some nice properties that it has, I assume. Is there any value, or have you considered having a spatially variable input instead of a single input?
Yes. So when maybe you'll appreciate this, everyone maybe can appreciate this, but you know, you write a proposal, right? So we write this proposal to NSF, and you know, we're gonna do, have multiple actuators, we're gonna do a continuous flow process with different zones. You know, we have big plans, but the first step is non-trivial. So yes, certainly one can do all of those things, and so we just have not gotten there yet. Absolutely. Absolutely you can, but you need to build that. Now you need to build your Markov state model in terms of multiple actuators. So that's kind of starts getting into curse of dimensionality problems.
Would you be able to share with us any of the kind of
Sure. So there's a professor who was on this grant, not part of this particular study, but part of the larger grant, Ben Shapiro, at the University of Maryland. And he has built microfluidic devices to do electrical manipulation of particles, and has many more than four electrodes around. Okay, so that's one thing that you could do, is you could just make a ring that had more electrodes. And so as a next step, we would just like to sort of push and pull in the two directions. Right now, everything pushes to the middle or pulls out. So just adding one more direction where we could shear the system, we think would provide more actuation, especially we're interested in rod-shaped particles and liquid crystalline configurations that would form. So that's one, next direction that we're envisioning. But the dynamic programming becomes much more complicated when you have multiple actuators and you're discretizing everything. But we were not at all limited by computation. The calculating the optimal control policy ahead of time, that we will use for all time and all state, only took a minute or something. And so we're nowhere near the limits of dynamic programming computation here, But the other system that we were really thinking about in terms of scale up and manufacturing or moving closer to it would be to have this is a batch system, it's just closed, but to have a continuous flow system. And then you wouldn't actually have to change, the voltage necessarily. You could see I'm forming a defect here, but it's going to go down here, and you have different zones, and then maybe you can change them more slowly. Maybe you can bring in temperature, which is hard to change as fast as voltage. But we can have, we aren't limited to voltage as our actuation modality either. We can bring in magnetics, we can bring in temperature. So there's certainly a lot of options. And
mm-hmm. One more question. What's a KT scale interaction, and how does that enable the reversible assembly?
Sure. So K here is Boltzmann's constant, and T is temperature. So what it's saying is that the interactions should be of the same order as thermal motion. And so that way, if you get into this well, your thermal motion will get you over to another well. So that's what that means. Yeah.
Okay, I think we're out of time. So let's thank Professor Grover one more time.
Thank you.